So we've got a lot coming up this week. Harry gave me this little pamphlet thing here. And so Monday, May 31st, and I don't know if some of these were up there or not. Sometimes I feel kind of dumb standing up here, for lack of a better term, because I feel like everything that I present to you guys that has been given to me has already been on the wall. You've read it. It's like, what's the purpose of this guy standing?
We like to be read to.
Do you like to be read to? You know what? I like you. You need to come back here and give me this. Okay, so anyway, Monday, May 31st at 10 o'clock, the Honor Guard is having a ceremony at the Manchester Cemetery. The way I understand it, it's well worth going to. It's wonderful, and it doesn't take forever. It's not a real long, drawn-out process, but it is a really cool deal what is done out at the cemetery. So again, guys, that's tomorrow at 10 in the morning. And then Wednesday, June 2nd at 6:30, we've got a Bible study, and it's called Unraveling Genesis. And Dave, are you involved in that?
A little.
Good.
Okay. You want to read past?
What's that? Yes, go right ahead. Please.
Right with me.
You want this, or can you just talk to him?
Oh, I don't know.
No.
Okay. Oh, well, I am. But thank you.
Okay. Boy, the bike.
About Wednesday. I'll probably do a better job this week. I want to remind everybody, please, this series, children 8 years and up will understand it. And I think right now with school, I mean, let's face it, school, be it middle school, high school, college, the science they're teaching, but plainly it's the devil's science. You know, it's all evolution, there's no God. So if you've got any children going into high school or going into college, please invite them and bring them. This series that we have is ammunition against that. Okay, we're going to learn how science, true, hard science, backs up Genesis. That there is a grand designer behind it all, and it's going to increase our knowledge and our faith, I promise. So please, or any friends you've got, please bring them in, and we will all learn together. It's really it's a great series. I promise you'll enjoy it. All right, so thank you.
Thanks, Dave. And when he says he promises you'll enjoy it, guys, you just can't help but notice Dave's excitement and his drive and his motivation and his love for the Lord. And if he's got much to do with it, I'm sure it will be exciting, Dave. So thanks for saying something and putting us all. And then, all right, so moving on from that, guys, Thursday, June 3rd at 6:30, it's ladies' night out. Back to having that. Mama Stopping said supper is provided. And all ladies are welcome to come. And she wants me to emphasize to bring a friend, too. So, ladies, if again, that's June 3rd, 6:30, bring a friend. Invite somebody. It's a great outreach that our church does. And it's not just inviting them to a Sunday morning service, it's kind of getting them involved in the church and inviting them in a different way, giving you a different avenue to invite somebody to church. High school girls and on up. If you didn't hear that, it's for high school girls and on up. So how cool would it be if like you had 25 high school girls show up? I mean, it'd be neat, you know, to have the young people flow in through the doors. Or not just that. It'd be cool if we could win. And then anyway. So Saturday, June 5th, from 5 to 7, pork chop supper benefit at the Manchester to benefit. So I'm assuming that the pork chop supper is not at the Manchester Cemetery. I'm not certain, where is that?
The park.
Oh, it's the park. Okay, so for those of you who didn't know that, which I think that's kind of been a staple in the community for years, hasn't it, guys? So we most of us know where that's at and it's taking place. And last but not least, Harry's got down here, Caitlin Cooper's great sister-in-law on the two-way. Amen. It's good to see you this morning, Caitlin. All right, and with all that being said, now I don't know who I'm opening it up to. I don't know if it's, I guess it's Aaron here. She's going to come up and listen to some music, guys. Oh, wait a minute. Neil, you can go take a leak down if you need to. I thought that's how you were raising your hand. Neil said for me to let y'all know there's no service tonight, so that's why he was raising his hand and getting my. I thought maybe he
how about we sing a cappella? That's what we're going to do. So, I'm going to sing some of the classics from the hymnal. So, if you want your hymnal here, it's going to have the words up anyway. But we're going to start with page 353, Victory in Jesus. So, please stand. We're going to do this. Just our voices. I told Randy, I said you don't have to have music to praise God. So, here we go. Here we go. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood.
He loved me and I Thank you. But before we do, you know, The song said, frowners never win. So here's what I want you to do right now. By the way, kids, if you're back in the back someplace, come on down front, would you please? You're waiting for me to say that, weren't you? Come on down, if you would. Move right on down. I would like to see right down front here, Wes included. I would like to see the biggest frown that you can give me. The biggest. Ooh, starting right out. Right. Okay. Some more frowns. Oh, there's a good one too. A little more. Oh my goodness. Even got the forehead into that one over there. Well, you know what? As I think about frowning, God knew that there'd be sorrow. He knew there'd be some pain. He knew there'd be some disappointment. And God knew that sometimes boys and girls would frown without having pain. They would frown because they don't get their what? Their own way. So you know what God did? God gave you 43 muscles in the face to frown. 43 muscles. He wanted to make it hard for you to frown. But I want to tell you what, He made it very easy for you to smile. Because it only takes 17 muscles to bring out a smile. Isn't God good? Give Him praise today, you know? I'm waiting. Give God praise. Now, Anna, where are you at? Would you come up here, please? Anna, can you climb up here? Do I need to bring you up here? Can you get up there on your own? Okay, all right. I think I'm ready to do this. Now, don't I look better?
Yeah.
Okay, well, I have some scripture I want to read, first of all, because I believe that God wants you and I to smile. I believe that with all my heart. Here's some scriptures. Psalm 68 and verse 3. May the righteous, may those who are born again believers in Jesus, may they rejoice before God. May they be glad. May they be happy and joyful. That's a directive, folks, for every single one of us in the house of God. And Proverbs 15, verse 13 and 15. A happy heart makes the face cheerful. The cheerful heart has a continual peace. I guarantee you, if you and I will smile as often as possible, we're going to have a continual peace. We're going to keep coming back to the table with a big smile, okay? Listen to this one. Proverbs 15, verse 30. A cheerful look brings joy to the heart. Look out there and give them a cheerful look. Smile. Now look at that. You brought joy to everyone in their hearts. That's what the Word of God says. A cheerful look brings joy to the heart, and good news gives health to the bones. And then one of my most favorites verses is Proverbs 17, 22. A cheerful heart, a cheerful disposition is good medicine. You know, whenever I go to the nursing home or I go to the hospital to make calls, I never wear one of these. I always wear one of these. Cheerful heart brings good medicine. Well, today, I brought something a little different with me. I brought two bowls. And these bowls, I want you to think of those bowls as being your life. Okay? So these two bowls are going to be what? Your life. And so never thought of yourself as being a bowl before, did you? But now, so what is this bowl? It's you gotta give her a good hand for that. Now, here, I have a lot of confetti. Oh, don't worry about that. Those grown-up adults can pick that stuff up. What we're gonna do, Anna, I'm gonna pour all this in here, but before I do, all this confetti is going to represent happiness, joy, and laughter. Okay? So what is this? Happiness, joy, and laughter. Okay? Smiles, okay? So we're going to pour it right in. Okay, now. the next question. Would you say that bowl is completely full or just half full? Oh, I don't think so. It's not overflowing. How full is it? About to right there. That's about how full it is, isn't it? It's only half full. It's half full of happiness, joy, laughter. That's your life. So I'm going to take this now and close it up. Now I'm going to bring it over here like this. Okay? And then what I'm going to do, I'm going to cover this up now, because I want to give you another scripture. In the Bible, it says, give, and it shall be given unto you. Pressed down, shaken together, overflowing into your lap. As you give, it will be given back into you. So as you and I take our joy and our laughter, and we shake it up, lo and behold, shake it up some more. Uh-oh. Oh, what's it starting to do? It is starting to overflow. Look at that. And what that says to me, Anna, is that as you and I give joy and happiness and laughter to others, it's going to overflow. It's going to overflow literally into our lives. Oh, yes. Would you catch some of that with your hands, please? Yes. And the laughter, the joy, the happiness is just going to keep coming out as you and I give it away to other people. Oh, my goodness. God has given you 17 muscles with which to smile. Yes. He doesn't intend for you to frown much. I bet she doesn't frown a whole lot, does she? Unless she doesn't give it away. Okay. By the way, I'm going to need some help after church. All this has to be rolled back up. It costs me $3 every time I do this trick. Oh my goodness. Just when you think all the laughter, all the joy, and all the happiness is over, oh, it's still coming. It does this for at least 20 more minutes. We have an hour sermon to follow. Oh my. What do you think about all that? It's still coming. I don't know how all I got in there. I think it's almost done. Oh, that's almost done. Oh, you want to get rid of it? Oh, okay. But just when you think there is no more, guess what? There is. Okay. You may be seated. I want to show you all something else real quick. You know, as I think about God's Word, I was reading the other day, and I opened up the Word. I was reading about the fact that in the book of Job, chapter 8, and verse 21, it says, "And God, He will fill your life with laughter, and your life with joy." And I thought about that, and I thought, you know, that's kind of a neat thing that God will do that. And what? 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 What'd you say? It's not on fire. But I can tell you this, what the Word of God says. The Word of God says, "Is not my word like a fire?" Wow. And so it is. No. I want you to capture Job chapter 8, verse 21, because it says there that laughter is given to us. What's the matter, son? Oh. Well, we don't want a fire in God's house. Okay. Are you ready for the message? Take your Bibles and turn, if you would, please, to Hebrews, the 12th chapter. By the way, I have to let you know I've already been praying and saying, God, what's the next chapter of my life? I'm still pretty young. So what's going to unfold in the near weeks ahead? I do want you to be praying for July the 18th through the 24th. That'll be the week that I'll be at church camp with the junior high kids. And so be praying for us that week. We'll be building our camp around the theme of Hebrews, the 6th chapter, 19th verse, where it speaks about hope is an anchor to our soul. Be praying for Pastor Pat and I. Pastor Pat is Pat Emily from the First Baptist Church up here in Edwardsville. And he and I have been directing camp for several years. Matter of fact, there was a time when he was one of my young people. Yes, Charlotte.
What'd I say?
I said Edwardsville.
Jacksonville. Thank you, sweetheart.
Edwardsville was where I was before here.
Okay. And but Pastor Pat was one of my young people in my church, and he eventually became our youth pastor. And then he got married and got the call of God to actually go into full-time ministry. So, but Hebrews chapter 12, I want us to look at that passage today. And before I give it to you, since you're tuned there, though, I want to share with you a true story. Many years ago, there was a 94-year young lady who passed away, and her name was Hazel Von Jecke. And Hazel was a beautiful child of God, a Christian woman, and when she passed away, she left directions for her pastor. And there was a time that I would, as a pastor, I would go to all my elderly people, my senior adults, and I would go to their home, and I would have a set of questions, and they would be on tape, and I would tape their recording of what they had to answer, and I'd ask them a lot of questions about their lives and about their faith. Well, Hazel left a letter for her pastor, and she told him what scripture she wanted read at her service, what clothing she wanted to wear. She gave him all this information for him. And then on a separate sheet of paper, on a separate piece of paper, she wrote these words, "Pastor, whatever you do, I want no male pallbearers. I want no male pallbearers. They would not take me out on a date when I was young. None of them would marry me, and so none of them is going to bury me." And that's a true story, you know? And so you talk about bitterness. This lady had a little bit of bitterness wrapped up in her spirit. And folks, I don't care who you are, there are times it's pretty hard to keep bitterness from overtaking our lives. You've had some tough journey in your lives here, and it's important for you now to close the chapter. It's time for you to close the book and write a whole new story for the life of this family and this church. Because bitterness can follow you all the way to the grave. It's a deadly poison, so we've got to get better and not bitter. Now in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, starting it down here around the, let's start at the 11th verse through 15. My concentration is going to be on the 15th verse. But verse 11, "No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. Make level paths for your feet, so the lame may not be disabled, but rather healed." Folks, listen to me. Sometimes we walk around in a crippled way, handicapped, at our own choosing. And the Word of God teaches us that we need to make level paths for our feet, because if we don't, it's going to interfere with the lives of others as well. Verse 14. "Make every effort to live in peace with all men and to be holy, for without holiness no one will see the Lord." And then verse 15. This is the verse I have carried in my own personal heart. "See to it that no one misses the grace of God, and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many." If I have learned anything at all in my years of ministry, years of marriage, and years of life, is this. I've got to be careful to take care of my heart emotionally. It's the seat of all emotions. Because you see, if I come home and I gripe and complain to my wife, what does she do? She takes that to heart. Now, I go back the next day, all of a sudden, say I'm working with Randy and he's the one I'm a little upset with and uptight with. We get together the next day and we've got to work these things out. And guess what? My wife's had no
chewing on all that. And guess what you're going to get next week, Brandy? A dirty look. Okay? Because she's still dealing with all that. I've got to be very careful that I walk level paths and I handle these issues. I want to define for you what bitterness is, according to Mr. Webster. It is that which is hard to bear, grievous, distressful. It is characterized by intense animosity. Have you really been angry with someone? Really mad about what has transpired, what has happened? Someone else defined bitterness as a hard hurt in the heart. Someone said to me not too long ago, I am still hurting inside because of what was done. Wow. See what that does? It's a harbored hurt in the heart. To harbor means to care for it. It means to cultivate it. It means to baby it along, to love it, to help it to grow, and to keep feeding it, to water it, and do everything that you can to make it grow. A lot of people have become enslaved to this master called bitterness. And the Word of God teaches us that there's only one person we are to be enslaved to, and that's Jesus Christ the Lord. Some people have literally been bitter towards God. I don't know if Pastor Joel has encountered it yet, but I certainly have in my ministry where people have been very bitter towards God because of someone's death that came about in their lives. Others, because of a disease. Some have been bitter towards their employer. Did you hear the news this past week? How many people were shot and killed? 9 people. Why? Because of a bitter employee. This happens all around the world today. Some are bitter towards their parents. Some are bitter towards their siblings. I've had funerals where the family would not even sit together at a funeral service because they have been bitter towards each other for years. And I guarantee you, you let someone die in the family, and all of a sudden the estate comes into play, and I guarantee you, in many cases, bitterness will erupt between siblings. My wife and I, we have a sibling who has not spoken to the sister for years, all because of bitterness and what has transpired. Bitterness. Sometimes we are bitter about a spouse that has walked out on them. My son-in-law has been blessed with a second time go-around. In other words, he married my daughter. But before he married my daughter, he had previously been married to someone else. Talk about bitterness. It was right there. And it's something that we had to struggle with and to move him out of that state and move him into a state of happy matrimony and love and caring. That happens. Bitterness. And bitterness, I'm sorry to say, takes place within the body of Christ. People leave the church and they're bitter for a long, long time. My brothers, sisters, this ought not to be. Let me give you the verse again, Hebrews 12:15. See to it that no one misses the grace of God, and that no bitter root grow up and cause trouble and defile many. So I want us to look at a couple things here. First of all, I want us to consider the deep root of bitterness. See to it that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. Now, we all understand what a root is. Now, do you have those pretty little flowers in your garden? Those pretty little yellow things? What are they called? Dandelions. I hate those dandelions. You know, and not too long ago, I went out to the farm at home, and I went to Home Depot. I went to Lowe's, and I wanted to find one of those things that have a hook on the end of it like this, you know? And my wife has one about that long, but she doesn't know. I'm getting old. I don't want to bend over that far. And so I was going to find me one about 4 foot long so I can move in the yard. You know what? I get aggressive when there's a root. I mean, I'll get so aggressive, I'll go get a spade if I have to. And those dandelions, if I have to, I'll go get a backhoe. Those babies are coming up and out. But you see, how many of us are that aggressive, that desirous of getting rid of those roots of bitterness that take over our lives? We have that. They're hard to weed out. But let me give you three reasons why we become bitter. A, number one, because of what somebody does to us. And B, because of what somebody says about us. And three, because of what somebody takes from us. Here's what I want you to do this morning. As we're in worship, and we're listening to the Holy Spirit speak to our hearts as we read the scripture, I want you to be in an attitude of prayer and say, God, lay on my heart what is truth here. And do I have a bitter root inside of me? Am I still clinging to something? Or have I yet aggressively, Lord, taken it out? Speak to me. Number two, second, there is the destructive fruit of bitterness. God is telling us in His Word that if you choose to be bitter, you're headed for a lot of trouble. And here's what concerns me. As a pastor with two daughters, and now two son-in-laws, and now the grandchildren, I have to be very careful how I speak about the body of Christ, and about my disappointments, about my frustrations. I've got to be very, very careful, because the Word of God teaches me that we may miss the grace of God because of that bitter attitude. And the Word of God says that it may defile your children, your son-in-laws, your daughters, and your grandchildren. And so I want to make sure that my wife and kids have a good taste in their mouths when it comes to the body of Christ, when it comes to the family of God. And so I hope that we hear that. And so consequently, we've got to be extremely, extremely careful. See to it that no one misses the grace of God. Now, I know that some people will say to me, Pastor, you have no idea what you're talking about. Because I have every right to be bitter. You don't know what he did to me. You don't know what she has said. You don't know what they put on Facebook. You don't know this and you don't know that. No, I don't know for that personally for you. I do know of someone who does. Someone who loves you, wants to get you past it. If you'll commit yourself to Him and say, God, it says my heart to be this way. Folks, listen to me. Bitterness is a poison that will contaminate you. It's a burden that will crush you. It's a blaze of fire that will consume you. It will destroy you and those closest to you. I want to give you three things that bitterness will do to you. Number one, it will saturate your mind. You'll go to bed at night, and guess what you'll think about? Shut that off my mind. I've been there. I've been there. I have laid in that bed, and I said, Lord, please remove this from me. Satan, away from me. I want to slam the door on you. Because it will saturate the mind. It just monopolizes. It takes over. I think about
thing about the lady who went to the doctor. It appears that she had some problems physically, and she went to the doctor, and she said, "Doc, I need an examination. I need some help." And so she goes to him, and the doctor says, "I've discovered your problem." "Okay, what is it?" She said, he says, "Ma'am, you've got rabies."
Rabies?
She mad. She reached in her purse, pulled out a tablet, and began to write. And the doctor looked at her and said, "Ma'am, what are you making out your will?" And she said, "No, I'm making out a list of names of people I'm going to bite." Folks, it will contaminate. It will saturate our minds. And number two, it will sadden our spirits. I have never, ever encountered a bitter, happy person. You can't be bitter and happy at the same time. Bitterness acts as a depressant. Bitterness will make us negative, cynical, pessimistic. Pessimistic, I didn't even say the word. It's what it does to us. Bitterness is like emotional quicksand. It will suck us down and under. It will suck the life right out of us. It's like a wind that will blow the candle of joy out of our life that God wants to have there. So we must deal with it. And here's something else that bitterness will do. It will sicken. It will sicken the body. Dr. S.I. McMillan has written a book entitled None of These Diseases. And in this book, he makes a list of over 50 diseases, ranging from ulcers to high blood pressure, that has direct encounter with this whole thing called the emotion of bitterness. We need to deal with it. God has not planned for you and I to be a bitter person. And by the way, bitterness does a great deal more damage to the vessel in which it is stored than on the one that it wants to pass it to. Keep that in mind. Now, here's some other things I want you to understand. Bitterness can poison your worship. You go back several years, and you take a look at the ones who are no longer present. And it has the issue of, or some in bitterness, it's spoiled, and it's poisoned their worship. Do you know what? For years, I couldn't hardly sing. You know what? Because someone sent me a letter, anonymously. And the letter said, "I never will forget it. I don't look at it the same way I used to, but I still remember it." But they sent me a letter and said, "Pastor Haun, you need to get out of the choir. And you need to let your wife come to the choir and sing." I took that letter. I took it to my bedroom. I opened up my top dresser drawer. I put that letter right in there. And you know where else it was at? In my heart. How many of you think I was bitter for a while?
I was. I wanted to know who did this.
And I wanted to somehow get a little revenge in some way. Are we human? Yes, we are. God knows our human state. Bitterness, it will saturate your mind, sicken your body. It will poison your ability to pray. You ask someone who's bitter, really bitter, "Would you pray for us today?" No. I'll pass. What someone else is doing. It's what bitterness does. It'll poison our ability to sing with joy. It'll poison our witness. And it'll poison our desire to serve. And here's point number three I want to make. How are we going to get rid of bitterness? We're going to do it through the dynamic power of forgiveness. We're going to do it through the dynamic power of forgiveness. Now, there are two principles that I want to give to you. First one is this. Forget the problem. Forget the problem. The Bible says in Ephesians 4:31, get rid of all bitterness. Forget the problem.
rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every other form of malice. To get rid of means to put away. It means to literally throw it in the garbage can, to dispose of it, to discard it. Forget the problem. Bury it both now and forevermore. Let's not speak about this again. Let's just bury it. And secondly, this becomes a hard one. Forgive the person. Forgive the person. Last night as I was sitting in my basement thinking about this, and I thought, Lord, you want us to forgive what they've done to us. You want us to take this, and you want us to bring it to you. You want us to bring it to you, Father, and you want us to give it to you. And you want us to forgive them for what they have done. But Father, it's so hard for me to do it. It's hard for me to let go of it. And God says, let go. Let go and give it to me. But all so often what we do, we have a tendency to want to simply hang on to it. And we cannot do that. If you want to be healthy spiritually, you have to get rid of every bit of bitterness in your lives. We must forget the problem and forgive the person. Now, let me give you Ephesians 4:32 for us. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as Christ and God has forgiven you. Now, three rules for forgiveness. Three rules to follow. The first rule is the golden rule. How many of you remember the golden rule? Dorothy, what is the golden rule? Do you remember? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Would you want people to forgive you? Of course you do. Then you must forgive them. That's the golden rule. But there's a second rule that I'd like to give you today, and that's God's rule. God's rule. You'll be forgiven in the same way that you forgive others. Remember our Lord in his prayer, Father, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And here's the rule I really like. It's called the grace rule. Ephesians 4, 31, 32 together now. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, and anger, brawling, and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind, compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God has forgiven you. So in other words, what that means for us is that by grace, we release that person for what they've said, what they've done, or what they've taken from us. We release them. We let it go. And here is three other points I would want to make to you now as we close. Number one, forgiveness is free. Forgiveness is free. Aren't you glad that Jesus paid it all? Amen. He paid it all. It didn't cost you one red cent to get your sins forgiven. You and I do not have to work our way into heaven. We don't have to try to earn our way into heaven. It's all by God's grace through Christ Jesus the Lord. It's by his stripes that we are healed. Forgiveness is free. It's free. No strings attached. No words at the bottom of the contract in fine print that we have to be sure to read. And secondly, forgiveness is full. Forgiveness is full. You know, Art, if you had a tumor and you went to the doctor and said, Doc, what about that tumor? And Doc says, yeah, that tumor's pretty bad. We're going to need to do surgery. And all of a sudden you ask the doc, well, Doc, are you going to be able to get it all? You're not going to leave part of it there, are you? And the doc says, we're going to take it all. It'll be fully removed from you. And now what are you doing? You're rejoicing. That's what we need to do. We need to rejoice that God's forgiveness for our sins is not only free, it's full. No sins remaining. Completely gone. The Word of God says in the book of Psalms
transgressions from us, never to be remembered again. It's full. It's full. And here is the third one. Forgiveness is final. It's final. I like what it says in the book of Jeremiah, the 31st chapter, the 34th verse. For I will forgive their wickedness, and I will remember their sins no more. I was telling Randy Cooper not too long ago that someone in the faith hurt me extremely deeply. And I have to be honest with you, I had a really, really tough time with that individual. But I knew that I could not walk around with any goodness in my spirit. And I had to forgive them freely, fully, finally. There was a few days I could hardly talk to that person without wanting to bite their head off. But I chose not to. But then I had to pray, God, give me a love in my heart for that person. And I pray for that person every single week. A week does not go by if I don't pray for that person. Folks, listen to me. Forgiveness must be full, free, and final. I don't know what God has spoken to your heart about today. I hope He's done two things. First of all, I hope that through Anna, He has shown you the importance of laughter. Because adults, if I were to speak to you today about laughter, I would say these things to you about laughter. I would say to you, laughter strengthens the body with heavenly medicine. Laughter lifts the spirit of those around you. Laughter also has been proven to help control pain. Laughter lowers blood pressure. That's a given. Laughter improves alertness and creativity. Oh, I'm not alert like I used to be. Laugh more. Okay? Medically proven. It provides a good workout for the heart. 15 minutes of laughter does wonders. By the way, 15 minutes of laughter will also cause you to lose 1 pound. All day long. Listen. Listen, folks. I want you to realize this is very, very important. And secondly, we've got to get rid of bitterness. Don't let it take over our lives, okay? Really important. Dear, I don't know what you had planned for the closing song. You have decided. All right. You've decided to find a song.
Okay. No, I know what you meant.
She's going to come up and lead us. She and her daughter. And would you join us as we sing that song? I decided to follow Jesus. And following Jesus includes getting rid of what bitterness contaminates and poisons. To follow Jesus means to receive the joy of the Lord. Do you know what Jesus said? These things have I told you. These things have I told you, so your joy might what? Be full. Just listen to God's word and read it. Be captivated by it. And begin to live it day by day. And your life will rejoice. Let's be standing.
I decided to follow Jesus.
we have decided to follow you, that means we must turn our backs on sin. We must turn our backs on being bitter. And we must be determined. We must aggressively, discerningly decide that we're going to deal with this issue and we're going to put it behind us. And we're going to walk in love one to another. I enjoyed that song that the children sang this morning, Father. Let the sun shine in. Face it with a grin. Because frowners, they just don't win. Smilers, they have to win. Father God, we're going to be a victorious people. We need to smile more and frown less. We need to just give ourselves wholly and fully to each other. I pray now your blessing upon this church, this family of God, upon their new pastor and family. And I pray, dear Father God, that we may see the fruit of their labor as they come to labor together with this flock. I pray, dear Father God, a year from now, we'll see an increase in numbers, an increase, dear Father, in attendance, an increase, dear Father, in souls that are strengthened, an increase in souls, dear Father, that are saved. I pray your spiritual blessing, your anointing of your Holy Spirit upon this congregation. Father, we love you. We give you praise. We want to walk with you all the days of our lives until one time, one day, Jesus comes again and receives us unto himself. In his name we pray. Amen. Amen.